Hello, everybody. A very warm welcome to all of you to the seminar on climate change and conflict in the Sahel, debunking the myth, a reality check for the EU's climate security nexus in the Sahel. My name is Denis Schrey. I'm the director of the Multinational Development Policy Dialogue of Konrad Adenauer Foundation in Brussels. In today's discussion, we will try to look at the link between climate change and conflict. Climate change has been widely perceived as a direct driver of conflict in the Sahel region. But from a closer perspective, the link between climate change and Sahelian conflicts is less clear. The argument goes very often as follows. Environmental degradation coupled with significant population growth leads to increasing competition for access to dwindling natural resources, which in turn generates violence and conflicts. While this argument is a captivating one, it is not always supported by conclusive and coherent evidence. Very often by drawing on extreme weather events such as droughts or floods and looking at climate variability over a certain period of time, causal relationships are being established which connect these events to the possibility of conflict and violence. While this might be applicable to many regions of the world, the ambiguity is that these assumptions are not reflected and supported by credible data on the Sahel. In today's discussion, therefore, we try to find out if this integrated approach to the Sahel based on a flawed climate security narrative is really relevant. To what extent is there also a need to revisit the donors' engagement in the Sahel region? In today's discussion, I would like to welcome, first of all, Mrs. Hildegard Bentele. She's a member of the European Parliament from the European People's Party. Hello, Mrs. Bentele. We also have invited Mr. Mamane, Garba, Hina, Bello, an economist at the University of Niamey. Currently, he's facing some difficulties in connecting to us because of the political situation. And we have Delina Goxho. She's an independent security analyst and focusing on the Sahel region for many years. Without further ado, I would like to give the floor to our moderator, Louis Mourier, the program manager for climate policy. Louis, I hand over to you.
Thank you very much, Denis, and welcome also from my side to our speakers and to our listeners and viewers. My name is Louis Mourier, Program Manager for Climate Policy at the Konrad Adenauer Foundation in Brussels, and I will be your moderator in today's discussion. Denis, I think you already pointed it. You already pointed it down. I think it's really high time to have a fresh look into the EU's climate security policy nexus, because in the past, there has been quite a consensus across policy communities that climate change is a key driver of conflict in the Sahel. But recent evidence, and this includes a paper by Delina Goxho that she will present today, has put this dominant climate security narrative a bit into question. And in fact, the link between climate change and insecurity in the region seems less obvious than one might assume on first glance. If this is correct, so if the finding of Delina is correct, it could have important consequences for the EU security policy and obviously also its development cooperation in the Sahel. So really important to have a closer look into the topic today. Before we start, just a little bit of housekeeping for our participants. You can ask questions through the Q&A function at the bottom of your screen, and we will then try to integrate these questions into our webinar. In any case, the last 10 to 15 minutes of the discussion are reserved for an exchange with the audience, and here we will give our best to address your comments and your questions. But now, let's not lose any further time, and let's get right into the debate. Delina, let me start with you. As I said, your paper does present quite a different view to the usual understanding of how climate interrelates with security in the Sahel. Your findings are also pretty much in contrast to the views of some leading think tanks, of the EU Regional Sahel Action Plan, even the United Nations, and also some Sahelian governments, which have also pointed to the impact of climate change on conflict in the Sahel. So let me be straightforward and let me be direct. Did all these organizations get it wrong? Please give us an overview of your findings and your paper.
Thank you, Louis. And hello, everyone. I really hope that our colleague Mamane will be able to connect later, but if not, we have provided he has provided us with some recordings of him addressing some of the points that we were making in the report and some of the concerns around this issue. The discussion around climate change and conflict is, I would say, at an initial phase. There are public events, conversations around this topic, and they have been mushrooming for quite some time now. And since the Sahel is what the EU Special Representative for the region called the new EU laboratory for foreign policy, also the climate conflict nexus is, of course, being currently discussed. To answer your question on whether we are overestimating, underestimating the impact of climate change on conflict in the region, because specifically we are talking about this region. I wouldn't want to address any other region in the world, because this is not what this research is. So we haven't overestimated it yet, I would say. In order to address some of these problems, instead of making this seemingly straightforward connection between the two, climate change and conflict, and instead of assuming that because climate change leads to desertification, then people fight each other more, we should be investing in credible and long-term research. And I suppose this is what good research does, doesn't it? It forces us to reconsider some of our assumptions. So as an example, amongst other scholars, Benjaminson, there is a 2012 research that provides sound empirical evidence which contrasts this direct climate conflict nexus. The authors have analyzed almost two decades of data on land use and disputes from the Court of Appeal in Mopti, which is a region in Mali. They have related then all of this data to climate variability, and the main finding of this research is that during this time, there was no significant correlation between the two. So for the Mopti case analyzed by Benjaminson, the correlation is weak or non-existent. I think it makes sense at this point to wonder how this nexus is reinforced, how this idea then came about within the policy circles that we're involved in. Back in 2019, a Niamey-based organization told me and a colleague of mine who were there for another research that they have to constantly switch the buzzword in order to get work done. A while ago, the buzzword was preventing violent extremism, then it was migration, and now climate seems to have the upper hand. So the resulting quick shift in donor priorities means that it is then difficult in the medium and long term to measure the impact on preventing and combating violent extremism, or respectively, limiting the impact of climate change. For Sahelian governments, of course, and this is what the key finding of this research is, the intent may not be as noble as getting the work done, which is what the NGO worker told us. Connecting rising violence and extremist attacks to climate change may provide for these governments yet another hook to attract investment or to stoke blame elsewhere and to say that this is not their responsibility. So this is all to say that what I'm arguing is not that climate has no impact whatsoever for the region, of course. The report shows that climate relates to other challenges in the region, but the link with conflict specifically is weak with regard to this particular region of the world. Thank you, Louis.
Thank you very much, Delina. I think some really good food for thought here already after only 10 minutes of the webinar. And I fully agree with you that we need to be careful to ensure a rather nuanced approach when it comes to the linkages between climate change and conflict in the Sahel, especially if data about the rather dominant climate security narrative is not backing up the nexus 100% for the moment. I would have loved to come to Mamane now, actually. It's really a pity that he cannot join us. As many of our viewers will know, there has been some quite political turmoil in Niger, where Mamane is from, in the recent days after the presidential elections. Unfortunately, internet has been cut. This has made the situation really difficult for him. But fortunately, he has sent us some voice messages, which I will present to you and what he has to say. And please excuse us for the inconvenience. But I think it's very interesting to hear his point on what Delina just said, not only because we have these crises at the moment in Niger, but also because Mamane has drafted a PhD thesis in 2019 about the climate security nexus in the Sahel. And he actually had a very different idea back then than Delina. He wrote, and I quote, "Climate change in fragile Sahelian communities is one of the key factors in transnational terrorism and inter-ethnic conflict." So this seems to be a quite different understanding of what Delina just presented to us. And I would be happy to hear what he has to say on the nexus. Please give me a second.
Hello, good morning to all. I'm Mamane Bello from the Niger Republic. I'm sorry if you are listening to this voice message, it is because the situation does not allow me to get connect. So sorry for that. Thank you also for inviting me on this session, I mean this webinar on climate change and conflict in the Sahel, debunking the myths. So actually my points I'm going to share them on four main points. The first one is to give an update of the country's situation right now, what Niger is facing, for 1 minute. My academic research.
Sorry for interrupting, but I just realized that Mamane actually joined us now to the webinar spontaneously. It did work. And Mamane, can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
Wonderful. Perfect. That's really good. We already started your voice message because we weren't sure about the Wi-Fi connection, but that's really good to hear that you can join us. Let me rephrase the question that I just sent, that I just asked you. And that was basically because Delina just presented her view on the climate security nexus in the Sahel. And you know that she has been quite critical in her paper that you prepared for us on the dominant climate security narrative. But in your PhD thesis that you drafted in 2019, you did present a quite different view on this matter. So I did want to ask you, what's your view on Delina's research? And are we underestimating the impact of climate change on conflicts in the Sahel? Please, over to you.
Hello, Luis, if you are listening to me, actually the internet will not allow me. I don't know how even I was to go. So I started hearing you sharing the voice message I sent to Delina. Please go ahead with them. I hope I can stay up to the caution sessions. Sorry for that, because actually the opposition leader joined the Niamey, and currently it is a complete blackout. There is no internet. I just went to my head, the DJ office, to get this one. So I'm here. I can't, I think it won't allow me to do that. Please go the audio if for that.
Of course, no problem at all. Thank you very much that you still managed to join us. I will go ahead now with the audio message. Please excuse me for this inconvenience to our listeners.
My argument on the report, Delina's report, that's the third point. And lastly, I'll be talking about future directions. So let me go straight on the update of the country's situation. Right now, what I realize is people, particularly in Niamey, felt that the election is rigged, and the international community, here they mean by, I mean France, is supporting the rigged election. For me, accusing France was not surprising, given the general bad perception of people, that people have on France. Unfortunately, again, from my understanding, they do not have the required educational level and information digestion capacity to differentiate between the EU position and the one of France. So they interchangeably use the EU, Europe, or France, but the image they are given is really for France, not the EU or Europe. So just to summarize it, the group protest right now is under control, but tension is in the air. Why? Because still we don't have internet, and no single minister is living in his house. They are all brought to hotel because area militancy can take anyone down very quickly, and it is difficult, even impossible, for the police to control it. So it is the group protest which is controlled, but not the area militancy. For me, ways out is simply maybe to push the opposition leader, who is under arrest now, to call for calm. Yes, sorry for that. I mean, just that's the small update. And on, I will talk about my academic research. Yes, I was saying I would like to talk about my academic research. Personally, I have a background on economics, and I did my research, my dissertation, which was titled Economic Analysis of Climate Change Induced Resource Scarcity and Armed Conflict. So this, the dissertation was just aiming to contribute to the understanding of the determinant of armed conflict between actors being defined as state and terrorist, farmers and herders in Niger, and of course, a context of climate change. So even from the title, one can understand that I was not targeting direct linkage or causality linkage between climate change and armed conflict, but indirect one. So the second point, which is my argument on Delina's report, the situation is mirrored with armed conflict, which existed on different type. We have different type of those conflicts. We have conflict between agriculture actors, farmers and herders. This kind of conflict, we've been facing it for, long time. We know about rebellion in the Sahel. We know about intercommunal violence, which is mainly due to land heritage or water resources dispute. We know about intergroup violence, which mainly sometimes it is due to marriage issues or mockery. But the ongoing terrorism activity, it is difficult to read it and it is difficult to track the causes. So that is why I do agree with Delina's argument in the report in saying that direct link is not drawn between climate change and conflict in the Sahel. Of course, climate change is affecting livelihood and may contribute to weaken government's effort in responding to crisis. So if link there is, it is of indirect. Yes. And also, any intervention from international partners, I agree that partners such as EU should be cautious on the speech national or regional leaders will give in linking directly climate change and conflict. It matters in supporting technically with adaptation measures, negotiation skill, building projects to receive GCF funds. But should it be the main cooperation subject, topic? I agree with Delina, no. But dealing with poverty, inequalities, weak and corrupted justice and educational system, simply put, governance, improving governance, which will be trusted by citizens, not dictated by former colonial masters. As for the last point, for future cooperation, future directions, that's my last point. I believe that any future cooperation should be on first, one, correct development aid. By saying correct, less corrupted, not development aid, which is really giving much more inequalities between citizens. Second, strengthening local governance. Well, here the EU or its member states, some will think that, our countries will not need that because we will always talk about endurance. But I would like to say if the EU or member states, the good one, not doing it, it means they are leaving it to those who can blackmail. The third point I think will be good for cooperation is real epidemic help. Because by saying real, also I put it in quotation, malaria, meningitis, mussels, cholera, and so on. Because here, you may surely heard about it, coronavirus is being considered as not the main disease to deal with. The fourth point on possible future cooperation is on security. Because personally, I do believe through my research that the hope here is to see the EU as an entity not being represented by France or by its member states individually, just to avoid the feeling that the EU is being remissive with respect to the US, that an abnormal potus, Donald Trump here. And lastly, I would like to say, of course, climate change expertise will be needed. And I'm ending this in saying any intervention from the EU, from my understanding, should be also in a respectful dialogue which engages traditional and religious leaders and processes of mutual learning that do not dismiss local concern and belief. Thank you very much, and I'm sorry.
So thank you very much, Mamane. I'm not sure if you can hear me, but I think what we're doing today is a new level of flexibility and a new level of adaptation in times of corona. But I think actually, when it comes to the content of your voice messages, you actually mentioned some really important points here when it comes to supporting local governance and good governance in the region. And also, I think already you gave us some really good ideas where EU development cooperation should go in the next years. And therefore, let me come perhaps to Hildegard, to you, because you're a member of Parliament, of European Parliament, both in the Environment Committee, but also the Development Committee. You're also a former German diplomat. So obviously, you have some very good experience dealing with international affairs. And we have now heard from Delina, and we have heard from Mamane from the region itself, about the shortcomings of the dominant climate security narrative. And I think this is quite an accusation, actually, against big donors such as the EU, given that they have been strong advocates of an integrated approach towards the Sahel, which obviously does include a strong climate component. So with its climate security approach to the Sahel, has the EU applied the wrong focus? And do we need to revisit our engagement with the Sahel region?
Thank you very much for the initiative and the whole event. I think that's comes at the right moment, actually, because I think we are at the beginning of a new phase of programming, actually, also in the European Union, and we are currently discussing the EU-Africa strategy, as you know, and the EAS is about to come up with a new Sahel strategy. So we are, I think that's the right moment to talk about priorities, to talk about focus. And we only recently in the Development Committee voted on a report which was dealing with the impacts of climate change on vulnerable populations. So it was globally, but it had the same focus, the focus which I think Delina detected. There is a shift in the narrative or in the priorities in development aid and also in external policies, which is of course can be taken back to the Green Deal priority of Ursula von der Leyen, which I fully support. But which is, of course, I think, a narrative from the West, which is, of course, now being spread all over the world, which is, I think, true and right to a certain extent. But what I also saw in the first discussion we also have about the new finance instrument in the European Union. We still call it, I think, NDK, or we call it Global Europe, or however. We are having discussions about priorities here, and there is the general approach to spend 30% on climate protection or in environment protection overall on all measures, also on the Next Generation EU and so on. So in general, this is a new approach, which I also support. I think we have to be careful, because this is what I also realized in the first discussions we had about the Parliament made the attempt to introduce a nomenclatura for the new global instrument. So we wanted to have a say in the priorities, and I could see that the point you made about governance, democracy, rule of law, institution building was not really present. So this was already something I detected, and I also detected, this is due to the fact that I'm a newcomer to this parliament, that in the last legislature we even had the position of the parliament to spend 45% on climate protection, and this position was just reiterated in this report, which we did not agree to on EPP, because I think you really have to, if you spend 30% on climate change, and now we have a new priority also on health, So you have a lot of priorities, and you should really think then what is our structural backbone? And our structural backbone is rule of law, is institution building, are the legal frameworks. I have the feeling that this is coming under pressure. So I see the risk, which Delina is also pointing at, that we have a new narrative, which is now mainly taken up by Western leaders and brought into development cooperation. And we have to be careful not to overstretch this kind of narrative. I think there is, of course, a point that we have to make sure that energy transition in developing countries goes the right way, that we do not make the same mistakes like in industrialized countries. This is for sure. We have an interest to promote climate protection, but it's not all about climate protection. I mean, we have maybe much worse environmental degradation by conflict, and we have much worse consequences by preventing human development by permanent conflicts. So I do see the point that we have to pay attention, that we do not shift now because this is the new trend or the new tendency to climate protection. But I can see this risk. I do see this risk, and I see the risk regarding the figures I just mentioned, that this was for the last term. And I mean, I'm happy to promote the 30%. This is an increase, I think, in development aid from 22 or something, or 25 to 30%. We focus more on environmental protection. On top comes biodiversity. As far as I know, this is not included in the 30%. So we do have a focus, and we have a shift in refocusing our aid. But I do understand, and your findings underline this, that we should not lose out of focus the governance, the institutions, the rule of law, and the democracy promotion. I think that's the right time now to mention it, because we will have a geopolitical dialogue with the Commission. I think this is how it's called under the new instrument. And we have to make sure that these priorities are being done right. And I see another problem, and this is also is coming up. We have, of course, two services. We have the EAS and we have the DEFCO, who are dealing with Africa, who are dealing with Sahel. And we have now security, environment, development cooperation. So we have to make sure that we get a coherent approach, and that we do not have conflicting interests here, and that we have one hand knows what the other hand is doing. I see there's a big danger. I say this in my function as a permanent rapporteur on policy coherence.
Thank you so much, Hildegard. I think some really important insights here, and especially as you mentioned, the new programming that is upcoming now. It's really an important point now to have a closer look on how EU development policy in the region should look like in an ideal case. And I think it's also important to stay on this topic a bit further because of another reason. I think in the past weeks, we have seen that military operations have not made the progress that we hoped for a few years ago. And there has been quite some talk lately about a so-called civilian surge in the Sahel. So basically a stronger emphasis on how development can contribute to stabilizing the region. And therefore, Delina, let me get back to you. I'm wondering how we can get development policy right based on the comments of Hildegard, but of course also based on your paper, and where climate comes in here. You already mentioned that in the past, the focus of EU development policy in the Sahel has shifted from one topic to another. I think a few years ago, it was violent extremism. Then after 2015, it was migration. And now climate seems to be the key factor, even though your research shows that tackling resource scarcity may not automatically reduce conflicts in the Sahel. So what can we learn from this for the EU's development strategy in the Sahel? Is Hildegard right that we basically have been exporting our domestic priorities to our development cooperation in the region? And what do you think the real focus of the EU should be on in its development cooperation with the Sahel?
Yeah, you summarized all of this so well. I'm very impressed. At at the very recent, I think it would make sense to mention the recent summit in N'Djamena, which gathered the heads of state of the G5 Sahel countries in particular. We saw many positive developments at the summit, which will now, of course, need to be followed by serious implementation. I think I want to mention point 21, which I know is slightly technical, but I think is exactly what you were saying. So it connects well to the civilian surge idea. And the point 21 of this communique of the heads of state recalled the importance of ensuring the redeployment of administrations and basic services for the benefit of populations, which is the civil surge idea. I think key in this communique, I find the expression mutual accountability between the G5 Sahel states and their partners, which is in this case us. The establishment within the European Union of the P3S Secretariat, which is a new office that is dealing with partnership for security and stability in the Sahel, it shows this new office shows a recognition of a need for the extension of the scope of action of Pillar 3 of the Coalition pour le Sahel, which is the deployment of basic services to population. What I believe, however, would be important to mention is that in some cases, development aid can also exacerbate conflict dynamics by, for example, and I think this is something that comes out of this research, by increasing the value of land. So what has been highlighted by recent literature to have an impact on the probability of conflict is precisely what we've been talking about for a while, Louis, which is this idea of volatility of aid. One example of when aid is counterproductive is provided, and again, I think examples are more illuminating than general concepts, by the work of the Opération de Développement de l'Élevage dans la région de Mopti, is once again the Mopti region in Mali, which this opération supported the construction of the Tolodje wells in a specific pastoral reserve. The construction of the wells, however, only exacerbated rather than relieving tensions, as it ultimately increased the value of land. So European-funded development projects, and I connect here to your initial question, these development projects that tackle climate change need to be revisited and credible mediation and law enforcement installed. Seeing external interventions merely as technical support tends to ignore the political dimensions of aid. And so I believe what is missing to a European approach in the region is this stronger political component and a stronger political will.
Thank you very much, Delina, for these very important points on where we can move with development cooperation. I also think you made a very good point that if we do not pay attention to details, development aid can even exacerbate conflicts rather than mitigating them. And I think that's a very important point to keep in mind. We have one question from a participant that has already been answered, actually. It is from a colleague from GIZ who asked, where can I have access to Delina's paper? It is in the chat for all participants. If you want to look, have a look into Delina's paper, just follow the link that has been posted by our intern, Anne-Eleonore, who's managing the questions in the background. I want still to move forward with the topic of development cooperation. But I think despite all the criticism towards the EU, which I think is totally fair, perhaps it would be a bit short-sighted to put all the blame on donors only. Because just as donors, Sahelian governments have been nurturing the climate security narrative in the past years as well. And actually, in your paper, Delina, you say that climate change is sometimes used by Sahelian leaders to withdraw themselves from their responsibility for conflict. And I actually want to ask the question to Mamane. It's not possible at the moment. So, Delina, let me come back to you on that topic.
It is. Oh, Louis. Hello.
It is. Yes. Wonderful. I didn't know. That's great. So let me ask you that question, Mamane. Is Delina right? I mean, have political leaders in the Sahel used climate change to stoke the blame for conflicts and for instability elsewhere? And how can Sahelian governments play their part in finding the right development approach that accounts for, but not overestimates, climate change?
Thank you very much, Louis. Thank you. Well, I would start in saying, first of all, I don't know how our partners are taking our leaders. For me, they are very smart people. You look at them as dull. They are very smart. Whatever is going to bring money, for money to be directed to any direction, they want it. You want to talk about climate change, they will talk about climate change. You want to talk about something, they will talk. So it's like this kind of game, I don't know how to put it. So of course, they do accuse it. I don't know whether you remember to La Déclaration de Politique Générale of the Prime Minister and also the President when he was 13. They all direct climate change to be caused. This is a causality linkage for them. The causality linkage that climate change is causing directly. It is even not indirect. So they always take this speech and they are following how partners, what partners wanted to talk about. The real situation is if you take not even climate change alone, like this COVID issue, they talk while the population down. Believe me, Luis, they don't think about even coronavirus, but our government people are talking at international level, they are adding numbers. It on the ground, no, people does not believe that corona has no effect on them. They are just living as they used. I don't know how it is scientific on this subject, we'll tell it. So if you take, that's how they do. Internationally, when there is an ongoing track, they will follow it as far as there is money. Unfortunately, money which will not be used for development activities, but money which will be redirected to, I mean, blackmail someone or to arrest opposition leader or to do whatever they want. So I do agree, of course, with what Delina was saying on this climate topic. But I'm still insisting that it is very important because personally, when I was funded to do my PhD with German government through the Federal Ministry of Germany of Education, we heard some experience, which it is one level in a given subject, which is climate change. So it is important to even know about what is going on, but it does not be what people should be keeping as the only topic to be talking about while the real population is starving. And whenever money comes for any project, it is redirected. I don't know whether I answered the question.
Yes, absolutely. Thank you very much, Mamane. Hello? Thank you also for your very honest comments, actually, especially at the beginning, where you mentioned that, of course, it's also about attracting financial resources and you know, being in line with donors, perhaps. I see a lot of questions in the chat. Also some challenging your research, Delina, which I think is great, and because that's what we're here for have a proper discussion. But I do want to come back to Hildegard for one final question, perhaps, before we can open the floor to the audience. Because in the chat, there's also a question on climate adaptation. And of course, as a member of European Parliament sitting in the ENVI committee, you know that the EU has just launched a new climate adaptation strategy. There's also a lot more talk at the in the past weeks about this Great Green Wall project in the Sahel, with some European leaders making some pretty bold financial and political commitments. But based on what we heard today, it seems that climate adaptation alone will not be the solution for the Sahel. In fact, it can be counterproductive to stability if climate adaptation measures are designed in the wrong manner. So is this reflected in the EU's new climate adaptation policies? I mean, is there enough awareness that adaptation needs to be coupled with governance and security mechanisms?
Very good question. And this is why I want to bring the EU adaptation strategy on the agenda of the Development Committee, because we have exactly to talk about this. And my question to Delina would be, I think you said that if you want to do environmental protection measures through development aid, they should be conditional. Did I get this right? So what would the conditions be? So if we give money for environmental protection aid measures, what kind of conditions should be attached to them? I mean, I'm very open to the concept of conditions. But do you have an idea what it should be? Because it could be that they should be directly to the local communities, to the local level. It could be that we ask for the change of legal frameworks on environmental protection, since we know that the legal framework is very weak and that there's no implementation if there is a framework, that there's not enough trained staff. So what could be the conditions attached to environmental aid protection measures?
Thank you, Hildegard. This is one of my favorite questions. And I tend to I tend to like this question in particular with regard to most of my work, which focuses on security. I think the same lessons could be applied in the case of climate. So, for example, having safeguards in place that guarantee for a certain behavior on the part of local leaders, or having a judicial system that is functioning, having ex ante conditionality measures and ex post conditionality measures that do a monitoring and evaluation of all the projects and what these projects led to. Of course, you need a lot of political will, both on the part of the donors, but also of local governments, to be able to do this in the long term and in general measure the effectiveness that shouldn't only be based on outputs. And so, you know, the amount of wells built, but it should be measuring for the outcomes. So how many people now have access to water? What is their situation? What do they believe of this? I think one major problem, and we hear this constantly, but we don't seem to be taking this very much into account because the way we treat leaders in the region is as credible partners, whereas we should be problematizing this vision more. One massive problem is this issue with the judicial system. So judicial systems in some areas of the region, which again doesn't mean that the whole region is affected by this, tend to either lack resources or willingness. And this is where the biggest question comes about. Is it a matter of lack of resources? Because if this is the problem, then we should be providing capacity. Or is it a lack of willingness? Because in this case, we should be attaching way more conditionality to the aid that we provide. So all of this tends to exacerbate the potential for conflict. And so, for example, discriminatory practices tend to make ethnic conflict more likely. One interviewee during the calls that we had drafting this report mentioned that erratic rainfalls make it harder for herders, for example, in Mali and in Niger, to provide for their cattle, which of course they then end up selling in larger number than usual into markets. Security forces in turn tend to connect this with terrorism financing because they believe that people sell their cattle in order to provide more money to terrorist groups. And so they tend to punish herders, which are Fulani ethnically more often than other ethnic groups, whenever they see them sell these large quantities of cattle. I think this example tends to illuminate a whole set of problems for the region.
Thank you very much, Delina. There are really a lot of good questions in the chat, so I will try to be as quick as possible. But we have one final open question to all our participants, our speakers, and I would ask you to perhaps stay within 30 seconds to answer it before we then open the floor to the audience, because we have been quite critical of the climate security narrative today. And the EU at the moment is preparing a new Sahel strategy. So I wondered, given our criticism of the nexus, should climate be an essential part of the strategy? And if yes, where exactly should it come in? Perhaps Mamane, you would like to go that first.
Thank you very much, Luis. That what I was is with this new strategy the EU is building, if it has to deal with the Sahel problems on climate change. I think, yes, it is important, but what I'm insisting on is not to really consider the key problem to deal with. And if it has to come, it has to come through expertise. I mean, Germany, I'm not saying the EU here, Germany is already doing it in West Africa, building climate change expert who will get together and build project to get funding from international GCF, that global finance, climate finance. So if this is, generalized up to EU level, I think it will be a good solution because it is already a very good educational program, which is really building capable people who can do the job on climate change, but negotiation skill at international level, and also in building climate and doing research. So if it has to come for me, it is just the need to generalize this system of building expert on climate change.
Perfect, thank you, Mamane. Because can I give the question perhaps to Linia? What's your view on the Sahel strategy?
We know that it's going to be a very short document, so it's going to be very condensed. I am sure that climate will have to be in there. What I'm hoping is that it is not connected to the conflict issue. So this is the only recommendation that I would make. Climate has to be there, of course, but as Mamane says, it shouldn't be number one priority, which I don't believe it will be in any case. I think Perfect. What will be interesting with this document is that because it's going to be so short, then we will have a lot to unpick once it's out.
Perfect. Thank you very much. Hildegard, same question for you.
Well, the important issue for us is to bring it also in the development committee, because currently it's dealt with in the foreign affairs committee. So, but I would align myself with Delina. I mean, as I said also previously, that we have to see what is the weight of climate change. I mean, if we also see education, if we see employment opportunities, I mean, we have to ponder, you know, I think we should give it a place, but not that too prominent and not essential place, because as your findings are telling, this is maybe too much. So, I mean, I'm glad to have had your ideas and your facts, and you know, try to talk to my colleagues in AFET and also bring the discussion into the development committee, because this is where we then also program.
Perfect. Thank you so much, Hildegard, for this very clear answer. And I think I agree. The DEVI committee should be kind of part of this process. This should be this would be very important, I assume. So, but now let me open the floor to the audience. And we have a number of very interesting questions. I just see here one that touches a bit on climate change adaptation. It is from Rob McNeil. And he says that investing in climate change adaptation plays a role in countering the root causes of violent extremist recruitment. And he also says that there is no quick fix to the changes in the Sahel. And the question is, perhaps to you, Hildegard, and to you, Delina, does the EU have the strategic patience to take a 10-plus-year approach to find solutions on the ongoing challenges of the region?
Hildegard, you can go ahead. I think this would be more of a question for you, perhaps.
I think everybody is aware that we do not have quick solutions for the Sahel. I mean, well, of course, I think we have to distinguish between putting soldiers on the ground and doing development aid. I think I cannot say for the patients how long we will support the military missions, but I think we still, everybody is aware of the fact that this is the Sahel is the region where a lot of, you know, problems come out of it. So, of course, we need to have a long-term perspective, no doubt about it.
Delina, please.
From a security point of view, the EU hasn't been in the region for a very long time, but from a development point of view, it's been since 2008, I think, if I recall correctly. So I think there is, if the long-term planning were there, we would be able to foresee that the EU will keep staying there. It's just that this planning should be accompanied by the fact that we know that we will be there for a long time.
Perfect. Thank you very much. I have one question in the chat for Mamane. It says, can Mamane develop the quote structural backbone he mentioned, especially the correct development aid, and how concretely to deal with that? So basically the correct development aid. And Mamane, you also mentioned several times in your interventions that there is a need to have real expertise. And the question is, what do you mean by security and climate change expertise in detail?
Oh, okay, thank you very much, Luis. I was even answering this question through the chatting, but actually for me, what I mean by dealing with concrete aid or having concrete aid is, I think it has to be through a genuine path, not through, I mean, France management, because whenever the leaders, local one, I mean, our authorities, in the Sahel, they are considered not elected, but designated, then they have the right to mismanage. If you just look at the general issue in the Sahel on the Sahel management on security, even on any subject, you will always see the point of gathering of our leaders is France. Why is it not Germany? Why is it not Italy? So it is this image of there is someone who is supposing to represent those small nations. at a level of EU, I think it will give the right for anyone who is in power to respond to only one person in terms of managing the resources. So for me, that's, I mean by concrete aid, also not an aid which will exacerbate, Delina was saying, aid may exacerbate conflict, but through the path she gave. But I will add this one in saying, it will exacerbate it through creating much more, inequalities among the people, not only the land price, but people cannot access to basic needs, and they're seeing people also dealing with huge resources. Second point, the climate security expertise, that's what I was saying. Whenever you are investing on climate change related subjects, I'm talking about education. There are a lot of subjects today in this regard, both research and also academics, pure academics. So I think whenever they are grown, they are really trained, they can be a huge importance for the Sahel. So for me, that's what I mean by expertise of climate change and security expertise, yes.
Perfect. Thank you so much, Mamane, for that. There's a further question that I think is very interesting for you, Hildegard, because you mentioned that you work on policy coherence. And it is from Joyce Courtland. And he asks, how can donors in close collaboration with partners in the region can increase policy coherence in order to address the twin challenges of security and climate change?
I'm currently promoting the Team Europe approach, which came up with fighting the pandemic. Which, at least from Brussels, seen from Brussels, was effective and gave a framework to coordinate better under the supervision of the European Commission. This idea of this Team Europe approach is maybe something we should follow up. I mean, this is at least something what I recommend if we continue to deal with our aid in developing countries after the pandemic. We have tried also to with studies and hearings, that you have to cooperate and coordinate through the delegations in the host countries and so on. I'm too new in the subject to really to the resources are not getting bigger, they're getting scarcer. So the need for coordination is much bigger. I think everybody knows, and the competition is also very strong. If you look at China, that we have to, coordinate better and have better synergies. And at the same time, to make clear to our host countries that we are a big donor and that we are most often more influential and give more money than China. And there is no, with us, there's no dependency attached to it as it is with China, who hand out credits at the same at the same moment. So, but I'm also open to critics to the Team Europe approach, but until now, this was a good initiative, which proved to be effective and better. And I think we should use this approach also not to fight the pandemic or to combine our efforts, but also to use it in our general development aid cooperation.
Perfect. Thank you very much, Hildegard. And also, I'm very happy that you re-mentioned the Team Europe approach, which obviously is very important at the moment. And also, thank you for mentioning the geopolitical dimension of development cooperation, which definitely, at a time of big changes in geopolitical affairs, is an important factor. We have one final question, and I would like to give that question to you, Delina, because I think it comes from someone who is not 100% convinced of your statements, if I read that question correctly. It is from Louis-Philippe Caron, and he says, one of the greatest security risks in the region is the ongoing conflict between farmers and herders, exacerbated by the outcomes of climate change. Foreign investments can perhaps alleviate some of the problem, but land scarcity is not an issue that can be entirely solved through financing. How can the struggle be mitigated?
Okay, so it's a good question. We keep talking about prioritization, yeah? So we keep saying, where should we put the money? Where should we invest? Which type of investment has the better sort of return? I suppose if this is the concern, and from the perspective of the European Union, this is a major concern, where to prioritize. I think instead of prioritizing on climate change to solve conflict, the EU way more directly should prioritize on mediation and on good governance. So in assuring, I'm not saying that the question is incorrect and that the findings between conflict between farmers and herders are incorrect. This is also what Mamane's thesis says. What I'm saying is that if we are to prioritize, I think it makes more sense for the EU to prioritize on good governance rather than focus on climate change because of conflict. I understand that it is a bit of a killing two birds with one stone, but it is not the right way to look at it, I believe.
Perfect. Thank you very much, Delina, for these last comments. I'm very sorry, but time is running out too fast. I see there's a lot of interest in the topic to further be engaged in the future. Unfortunately, we slowly have to come to an end of the debate today. I think it was a very, very rich debate with some very important points raised by a range of people. And I hope that we can continue the discussion in the upcoming weeks and months. Let me close the debate for today. I hope we can continue the discussion in the future. Thank you very much to Hildegard, to Mamane from Niger, you're joining from a very difficult situation at the moment. So special thanks to you that you took, engaged today despite the very difficult situation. And of course, also thank you to Delina for your engagement. For our participants, Delina's paper can be found again in the chat, but also on the website of the Multinational Development Policy Dialogue of the Konrad Adenauer Foundation in Brussels. So please feel free to visit our website and of course follow us on all social media channels. That's it for today. Thank you very much again. We look forward to the next discussion. And until then, stay safe and goodbye.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Bye, thank you.